declare up front is that we leadership were about understanding how we operate as humans, right? And being able to collaborate in that way. So yes, it's incorporating the masculine and the feminine, but it's also a level of inclusiveness where I get to understand you as a human being.
Jenny, good to see you again here on We Leadership.
Hello, Damien. How are you today?
Well, thank you. I'm feeling very unconscious and I might be biased a little bit. And that's what I think the topic is today. How corny is that? Dad joke. Oh, my God. But that's the topic we're talking about today, sometimes how our unconscious bias, our previous experiences may color an interaction. And we may interpret things in a way that weren't intended. I mean, because that can happen a lot today. And also, too, how that affects conversations, because we can easily shut down a well-intended conversation because we've interpreted the wrong way and we get defensive or we even go on the attack. Is that, from that perspective, our unconscious biases, do they really affect us that much?
Absolutely. I would love to go to town on this topic, but when you understand what unconscious bias is and how it shows up, you start to see it in more places than you realize, So I've seen it in ads, local government ads, all sorts of places, unconscious bias shows up. And I think it's a good topic, but before we go into that, what's interesting or what's good to be able to sort of declare up front is that we leadership were about understanding how we operate as humans, right? And being able to collaborate in that way. So yes, it's incorporating the masculine and the feminine, but it's also a level of inclusiveness where I get to understand you as a human being in the full context of who you are and how you live and how you see the world. And you get to do that for me and other people. So when we're talking about unconscious bias, and because part of this conversation sort of started because of the whole politically correct, and what did you call it? The
gender correct.
Gender correct. And
GC.
Right.
I don't know if that exists. I made it up. So.
All right, that's good to know. I think what's good to start to, before we even delve into that conversation, is to really understand what are the foundational questions. Where's the place to stand in all of this? Because it's so easy to just go in and go, oh, well, that's wrong, or this is wrong, or I think this, or I think that, or I identify as, whatever. And make fun of it, or try and poke holes in it. But we're talking about collaboration, right? And we're talking about trying to understand each other, human to human. So, what do you think is a good place to stand in that conversation?
I love that clarification that you put out there. And the other part to that I want to add is, because when you look at it, if we go back in time when we had debates. And I'm going to reference Parliament as cringingly as I'm going to do that. But when they had debates, I like to think when it was first started, it was a discussion about the idea, and they're exploring the idea. Okay, we need to do something here, and let's explore the options. And I like to think that's how that was. But now we've moved, when we look at debates, to me, and the US's last presidential debate probably antiphifies, if that's the right word, it really highlights, I'm going to go that way, I'm struggling for a word there. That for me, debating has turned into two narcissists beating each other over the head with their opinion and nobody's listening. Mm-hmm. And I love that. That's why I really love why you've highlighted that, that what we really need to be doing, especially in leadership, is having that understanding, taking that step back and going, hey, maybe I'm not right. Maybe there's more here that I can learn from. And from that, through that learning, we can actually be better. Because again, when in today's world, it changes a lot. It changes really fast. And to say that we know anything, know everything, is kind of a bit arrogant. And so to even then spout, I mean, if you look at social media, it's a great example of where, you know, people jump on and they have these very strong opinions. But have they really stopped to take that time to step back and understand? And I'll draw from my son's karate sensei here. He has 5 D's to deal with conflict. And the first one is distance. Put some distance between yourself and the situation. And that doesn't, you know, it's not just physical, but in any situation. And that's, I think, where you're underscoring what you've just said is take that time to, you know, to listen, as opposed to having this strong opinion immediately up front without even considering what the other person might be putting forward.
Absolutely. You know, and I think that goes to get curious, you know, about the topic, and to get curious about people's perspective and why they think that way. You know, sort of last year, I guess, I was delivering a guest lecture for some students, and I had one student very passionate about the environment, and he sort of said, "Jenny, how do I convince people to understand what this whole environmental issue is about?" And I said, "Well, rather than trying to convince them, why don't you get curious about why they think the way they do? See if there's something in there that you can pick up in terms of an understanding or an insight about, you know, that would add depth to this whole argument. I mean, it might just validate how you feel, or it might just give you a completely different opinion. So, you know, in that whole unconscious bias, if we're curious, tell me, Damien, tell me where I, you know, I might not be seeing, and shine a light on some of these blind spots of things that never even occurred to me. Let me get curious about that. What could I learn about myself? What could I learn about you? How would that actually then build a bridge between where we are, as opposed to putting more dynamite and explosives in there and killing everybody in the process, you know?
Sorry, yeah.
Metaphor.
No, that's not right. But the point is, and you're right with that, what I've found with that curiosity from my own perspective and other examples, and I'll give you a great example in a second, is that we often find if we get curious that we have more in common than we do have that's different. And the example here I'm going to put forward is a friend of mine. He works with helping youth and adults, but in the trauma situation of where there's abuse and that kind of thing, and works with schools. And there was one particular school where they had these two gangs, and they were all constantly at each other, hated each other. And what he did was he asked the principal to send one of the gang leaders to one room, and then he sent asked the vice principal to send the other gang leader to a room as well. He didn't tell them that it was the same room. So they both turn up. He's there. They both turn up to this room, and they're like, "Oh my God!" And they're about to get at each other's throat, and he got in the middle and said, "Okay." And he went down and talked them through it and got them to see that they had more in common than they had different. And the thing was, the irony is, and it was pretty tragic, was he said 2 weeks after that, the father of one of the gang members died naturally, not because of any issues. But he said what was interesting is immediately the first people to show up at the house of the gang leader was the other gang leader and the gang saying, "How can we help?" And just through that understanding of putting aside that bias and going, actually, we have more in common here, all of a sudden there was a collaboration and a helpfulness in it, certainly in a traumatic situation as well, because certainly if that hadn't happened, those gang members wouldn't have been there helping, you know, the widow, the, you know, recently widowed woman, which is,
yeah, absolutely.
And I found that as a wonderful example of okay, we, if we put aside our biases, which is usually more on the surface, and look at the fundamentals of who we are, we find there's a connection there. And then we can start looking at things when we find that connection and we're not, haven't got those blinkers on, we can actually start to go, actually, there's that component here that you're suggesting would work, but this here is something that I'm considering. How do we work that together? And all of a sudden you create innovation, which is what innovation is. It's taking finding a whole new way of doing things.
Yeah, absolutely. Oh, wow. This is a very big topic, I think.
Yeah.
But certainly, I you know, it, as you said, it can spark something even bigger. But we've got to come together in a way of understanding first, and create a safe space for people to just be who they are and to see the world the way that they see it, as opposed to trying to drag people over to your point of view, or to convince them in the case of that student.
Yeah, I love that. Drag them over to your point of view. And that, I mean, when you really look at it, and I really want to call that out now when people do that, is that's a narcissistic approach to say your opinion is better than anyone else. I mean, that's a dictionary definition of what a narcissist is. And it's, so if you're not listening to the other side, and that's where your unconscious, as you talked about, the unconscious bias, that is your opinion. And to be able to take that time to listen, understand, to actually go, and I think part of that might come down to security as well, being secure enough in yourself that you can actually listen to someone else and that's okay, that it's not, that you're not losing anything by listening to someone else. Maybe we're going really off topic there with that, but
it is a big topic. And I think, you know, the fact that you brought up trauma and I think not understanding people's response to trauma is another aspect of this topic, because you really have, if you don't know what people have been through and you're simply lumping on them an opinion that you have that everybody should think this way, you're doing it from the point of view of the life that you've lived and the education that you've had. But clearly not everybody has had that level of education or those experiences, right? So we have, and innovation comes from that ability to see things at those different angles and to maximize and collaborate based on that. So there is a lot to gain from understanding. I think firstly, if we're going to tackle a topic like unconscious bias, then really understanding what are the foundations of the questions that we're asking first to be able to dive deep into this topic, so that we're not, it's not dysfunctional to start with. Because if we start with a I'm right, you're wrong, yes or no kind of binary, then there's a probable, almost certain future attached to that. But if we are in the inquiry of it, some really beautiful things can come out of that.
Exactly. And that's for a business as well. You've mentioned in innovation, and that's where your competitive advantage is as a business, is to find those innovations. And if you're doing things the same way with the same unconscious biases, and you don't have a framework within your organization in its operations to enable people to explore, to be able to innovate, it makes it really hard to grow as an organization. And if you're not growing, someone else is going to take over very quickly. And that innovation is really important. So I guess the focus is for this episode is to really have a good, clear understanding of what unconscious biases you might be bringing to the table yourself.
Yeah, and I think that's definitely an inquiry that is ongoing, you know, for people, and has the potential to spark some really amazing conversations if people are open and if they're willing to be in the conversation and explore it, you know, because as you said, sometimes people's defenses or their ability to feel secure or safe in those conversations can be challenged. And I think we need to be mindful of that as well.
Awesome. Again, lovely chatting. Great topics that we're talking about here. And thank you, Jenny, for sharing with the
audience. Yeah, really loving this, Damien. Thank you.